Good morning. Today's scripture reading comes from Romans 8, 1 through 4. Therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it is weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. God bless the reading of his word.
All right. Thank you, Ethan, for reading our scripture today. Today, we begin a study through one of the most magnificent passages of the Bible. I'm talking about Romans chapter 8. If I could summarize this mountaintop of the Bible in one sentence, it would be this: engage with the God who is engaged with you. Now, many of you have probably heard before the story of Derek Redmond. He was an Olympic runner. He competed in the 1992 Summer Olympics in Barcelona. And when the 400 semifinal began, he pulled out ahead of everyone else, and it looked like he was cruising to victory. But then he felt his hamstring pop, and he began to slow down and then began to hop. And pretty soon he dropped to his knees and began to pound his fists into the track in frustration and in pain. And it was at that point that something really remarkable happened. His father, Jim, was up in the grandstands watching him. But when this happened, he ran down onto the track, pushing by two security guards to get out there. And when he got to his son on the track, he put his arm around Derek and he said, "I'm here, son. We'll finish this together." And with thousands of people in the stands crying and cheering and clapping, father and son walked across the finish line and completed the race. Now that is a perfect image of God. He's not up in the grandstand sort of impassionately watching you and me run this race of life. He is deeply engaged with our lives. He's on the track with us, running with us, encouraging us, giving us strength. This is what we learn in Romans chapter 8. Let me tell you what we're going to be doing, God willing, across the next few weeks in the study of Romans chapter 8. You'll notice in your sermon notes that these verses are sort of broken up into what God has done for us in the past and what God is doing for us in the present and what God will do for us in the future. And so that's what we're going to be doing across the next several weeks. Today, we're going to look at these first four verses, the verses that Ethan read to us, that talk about what God has done for us in the past. And then next week, we'll look at the next section of verses, which talk about what God is doing with us in the present. And then we're going to look at another set of verses on week number 3, which tell us about what God will do for us in the future. And then on the fourth Sunday of February, we're going to look at the concluding verses, the last 10 verses of Romans chapter 8, verses 29 through 39, is one great exclamation point, one great doxology from Paul about the God who is deeply engaged in our lives. So let's jump in. Remember, the key word is engaged. Engage with a God who is engaged with you. And so we discover in these first four verses of Romans chapter 8 that God was ready to be engaged with us long before we even got here. You notice the verb tense in these verses is in the past tense. Circle the phrase "God did" in verse 3. For what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did. Now, what is the law? Most of us would say, well, it's the Ten Commandments. And that is a perfect manifestation of the law. But the law that Paul is talking about here is moral requirements. There are certain things we should do, and there are certain things we should avoid doing. That is the law. Now, David Zoll of Mockingbird Ministries said very accurately that even though our age is getting more and more secular and fewer people are going to church or reading the Bible, that doesn't mean we're no longer conscious of the law. Even somebody who's never read the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Even somebody who's never read the Ten Commandments or studied them. We are aware that there is a standard that we're supposed to live up to, and we fall short of it, even if we've never darkened the doors of a church. Here's what David Zoll of Mockingbird Ministry says. The law is an elemental force that we all experience every hour of every day. Present whenever we experience accusation and constraint and control and condemnation, which we are all constantly relying upon to justify ourselves. This means that the law is at work on us even when we aren't actually hearing specific divine commands. It is the air we breathe as human beings, the default setting, the quid pro quo that characterizes our internal life and much of our external one as well. Its underlying logic is embarrassingly familiar. To get approval, you have to achieve. Behavior precedes belovedness. Climb the ladder or else. The woman on the street may not have given the fifth chapter of Matthew's gospel a second thought since Sunday school, yet she is likely on intimate terms with the condemning echoes issuing from Madison Avenue. Thou shalt be skinny, successful, independent, self-actualized. She has long since grown accustomed to the internalized voice of a demanding parent, that feeling of never being quite enough, which drives so much of her striving and exhaustion. And he says, take busyness as an example. All of us, men or women, we recognize that. He says, when asked how we are doing, we used to say, fine. Today, as a number of commentators have noted, the default response when asked how we're doing is busy. But busyness is more than a description of how we're doing. It is one of our culture's predominant indicators of worth and value, a measure of personal righteousness. The implication is that if we're not overoccupied, we are inferior to those who are. As with all life-based barometers of self-worth, beauty, wealth, influence, youth, and so on, there is no enough. What the near universal obsession with busyness reveals is that everyone is religious, not just those who believe in God or go to church. Works righteousness, that is, the attempt to justify yourself by works of the law, is the default mode of human operation, not just of the select few who identify as religious. I think he's absolutely right. And here in Romans chapter 8, Paul says that the law is actually powerless to fix the shame and the guilt that you feel when you let down and you're not doing the standards or living up to the standards that God wants. And he says that the law has been weakened by the flesh. Now, what does he mean here by the flesh? We hear the word flesh and we think of skin, we think of sinful violations of sexual standards. And certainly there are standards when it comes to sexual behavior. But when the Bible speaks about our flesh, it's not just talking about that. It's talking about how we are weak in every way when it comes to being able to do what God wants us to do. So the law is ineffective at helping us overcome shame and guilt because our sinful nature is keeping us from being able to fulfill the law perfectly. Now you can react in one of four different ways to this reality. You can react with denial or blame shifting or despair or trusting in God. You can react with denial. I want you to consider the life of James Hammond. He was an antebellum plantation owner. He served terms as a congressman and as a governor. He had a formidable drive for political power. He also had an insatiable sexual appetite as well. In 1839, he purchased an 18-year-old slave named Sally and her infant daughter, Louisa. He sired several children by Sally, and then when Louisa reached the age of 12, he began taking her to bed, had several more children by her. In addition, Hammond was involved in molestation against some of the children in his own family. His wife finally gave up on him, and God obviously gave up on him as well, because a series of epidemics struck what Hammond referred to as his property, his livestock, and his slaves. And this led to a series of financial setbacks. And what's more, his brother-in-law threatened to go public with the sexual molestation, which would have ruined all of the ambitions he had for public office. And you would have thought that the man would have seen the handwriting on the wall. But here is a page out of his own diary. "It crushes me to the earth to see everything of mine so blasted around me. Negroes, cattle, mules, hogs, everything that has life around me seems to labor under some fated malediction. Never was a man so cursed. God, what have I done or omitted to do to deserve this fate?" Now, it's hard to believe that Hammond could be so clueless and fail to make the connection, but I've seen people as well who fail to make the connection between their behavior and the consequences of their behavior. And there are people who then deny, "Why would God be so mad at me? I mean, I've done nothing any worse than anybody else has," they say. "And besides, all those few little quibbling things that I've done, I've made up for them by doing a lot of good things, so the scales are balanced." So we deny that we have this shame and guilt within us. There's another way that we can respond to shame and guilt. We can shift the blame. Write that down. We can shift the blame. Circumstances are to blame for our failures. Biology is to blame for our failures. Other people are to blame for our failures. We say, I was tired, or they started it, or what can you expect with the kind of parents that I had growing up, and on it goes. But Jesus told us that the source of our failure is in our own heart. The Bible does not ignore the fact that we do have extenuating circumstances. We are impacted by the social surroundings. We are impacted by the influence of other people. We are impacted by the way we were raised by our parents and by our extended family and so on. But in the end, we can't shift the blame off of our own heart to those other sources. Our shame and guilt is there because it is deserved. Now, if we can't deny these things anymore, and if we can't shift the blame successfully anymore, the only other option we have is despair. And you can write that down. That's an option to shame and guilt, is to despair. In a Grammy-nominated song some years back called Fallen, Sarah McLachlan admitted what it feels like to finally reach the end of all her denials and all her blame shifting. Let's listen to a portion of this song.
Lost in those I thought were friends, to everyone I know. Oh, they turn their heads embarrassed, pretend that they don't see that it's one misstep, one slip before you know it. And there doesn't seem a way to be
She accurately communicates despair. But the thing that is so sad to me about that song is she doesn't suggest a way out of it. And so she recognizes that she can't shift the blame. She recognizes that she can't deny these things. But she's in a room with no exit sign. And remember what I said at the beginning of this message, that there are four options, one of four options we can take when it comes to our shame and our guilt. We can try to deny it. We can try to shift the blame. We can fall into despair. Or we can decide to trust in God. That's the fourth one, trust in God. In verse 3 of Romans chapter 8, Paul said that if we want a way to live a life free of guilt and shame, the law isn't the best tool for that. It's not because the law is weak or wrong. It's because we are unable to carry it out. But that's not the end of the verse. Paul said that what the law was powerless to do, God did. And how did God do it? The verse continues, God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. Now you have Christmas and you have Easter, in that one verse. You have Christmas. It said God sent his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. Do you know that's the Christmas story? That's the reason for Christmas? Matthew and Luke tell us about the wise men and the shepherds and the star of Bethlehem and so on. The Gospel of John tells us what's behind all of that. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. As the Apostle Paul puts it here, God sent his Son in the likeness of sinful man, likeness of sinful flesh. Now, when we are told that Jesus was sent in our likeness, that doesn't mean that he was pretending to be human. He was human in every way except what? He got tired like us, he got hungry like us, he suffered like us, he grieved like us, but he did not sin like us. Jesus went from the beginning of his life to the end of his life completely, consistently, always keeping the moral law. He had no guilt, he had no shame. But the astonishing thing is that the one who had no guilt or shame took on our guilt and shame so we wouldn't have to bear the consequences of it. I said that this verse has Christmas in it, but in just a few words, this verse also has Easter in it. God sent his son in the likeness of human flesh to be a sin offering. That's the way Paul put it, to be a sin offering. That's a reference to the Old Testament practice of sacrificing ceremonially clean animals. And so a worshiper would come to the temple, they would bring an appropriate animal to be sacrificed, and when the priest sacrificed that animal, as the animal died, the sin of that offering bringer died as well. Now, the Apostle Paul said that when Jesus died on the cross, he was being a sin offering. So all the offerings of the Old Testament and all the instructions for offering the Old Testament was designed to prepare God's people and point toward what would ultimately happen. Jesus would come with no shame or guilt of his own to put on his shoulders our shame and guilt and bear it away in his death. And that's why Romans chapter 8 begins with that shout of victory. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. What does it mean to be in Christ Jesus? It means to be united to him in such a close way that when God looks on your life, he now sees Jesus. When God looks upon your life, he sees Jesus' perfect life because you are united to Jesus. He sees Jesus' death for sin so that you're not having to bear the consequences of that. He sees Jesus' wonderful resurrection and glorification. He sees Jesus because you are united to him. So there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I want you to perform a little exercise. There in your sermon notes, you'll see that I've put a blank. There is now no condemnation for blank who is in Christ Jesus. I want you to put your name there. Why don't you go ahead and find a pen or a pencil in that spot and take a look at what you have written. This is the reality. This is the truth of your life right now. You are in Christ Jesus if you've committed yourself to Jesus, and so there is therefore now no condemnation for you. Now, if this is true, there are 1,000 implications. But since I don't have enough time to go over all 1,000 of those implications, let me mention just three. Write these down in your notes. First of all, the gospel impacts how you deal with yourself. You know, if you are going to fix something in your life, if you're going to correct something in your life, the first thing you have to do is just be brutally honest about where you've gone wrong, about the actions you've taken and the consequences that have come to your life and to others. Any therapist will tell you that. Any recovery group will tell you that you have to take a fearless, searching, moral inventory of your life. You are never going to do that, though, if you are in this sort of performance-based mentality that says, I have to perform a certain way in order for God to love me. Because as long as you're locked into that, you're going to have excuse away, justify, ignore, pretend that none of that stuff really happened in your life, because otherwise, you're going to be like that McLaughlin song. You're just going to be in this unbearable situation of being in a room with no exit sign. And so we need to realize that once we've received the gospel, once we understand that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, what does that do? That frees you up to be brutally honest with yourself and a few select others, and brutally honest to God in prayer about who you really are, because you don't have to depend on any of that stuff for God's approval or for God's love anymore. God already loves you. There's no condemnation for those who are united to Jesus Christ, and so now we can lay it all out. You know, the philosophers say, know yourself. The only way that you're going to really know yourself and all of your flaws and imperfections is to just know that none of that takes away God's love for you. And so when we trust the gospel, it impacts how you deal with yourself. Here's another thing. The gospel impacts how you deal with others. See, here's the reality. If you are living this sort of performance-based understanding of a relationship with God, if you are determining your worth based upon your performance, then you're also determining the worth of others based on their performance, aren't you? And so your marriage partner falls under that evaluation, and your kids fall under that evaluation, and your friends and your fellow church members fall under that evaluation. And what does that result in? Well, it results in a number of relationship-killing things, like intolerance and impatience and judgmentalism and hypocrisy. But if my relationship to God is not based on how I perform for Him, then I can turn around and base my relationship with others not on their performance toward me or their performance toward anyone else. Now, this doesn't mean there aren't any standards to hold people to. This doesn't mean that, you know, if you're in management in an office that you can't hold people to certain expectations. But when it comes to the deep relationships of our lives, we're not going to base our love for them upon their performance any more than God is basing His love for us upon our performance. Really accepting the gospel impacts how you deal with yourself and how you deal with others. Here's a third thing. The gospel impacts how you deal with God. You know, we sing that song, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. When was the last time you really considered yourself so wretched like that? When was the last time you were actually amazed by grace toward somebody like you? I mean stunned by it, slapped in the face by it. Something that was so amazing that you dropped to your knees because you couldn't stand anymore in the presence of a God who is so that's merciful to you. When was the last time that happened? You know, every church I've been in, there will always be people who talk about how to improve the worship service. Turn the music up. Turn the music down. Lower the lights. I can't see anymore. Raise the lights. Buy a fog machine. Play the old stuff. Play the newer stuff. Look, production elements are important. And selections about what is done on the stage is important. But if you want to come in here and really worship, it's not based upon what happens on this stage. It's based upon how clearly you understand the gospel in your heart. And that's true not only when it comes to worship, it's true when it comes to obeying God. You're never going to obey God as freely and as fully until you understand what He's done for you. And you're not going to trust God with the disappointments of your life and the unanswered prayers of your life until you really get the fact that God has given you the very best in Jesus Christ. How will He not also, the Bible tells us, along with Him, give us all things? We need to recognize that our relationship with God is entirely dependent upon how we get the gospel. So my invitation to you today is to believe the gospel. Some of you need to believe the gospel for the first time. That's how we start in the Christian life. We need to cross the line of faith. We need to stake our claim. We need to make our stand. We need to schedule our baptism. There is a start to the Christian life, and it starts by believing the gospel. But when I say you need to believe the gospel, some of you in here are probably thinking, well, I've done that. At least there's one thing the preacher's telling me to do that I don't need to worry about. I've already done that. I did that when I was 12. I did that when I was at a youth camp. I did that when somebody led us in the sinner's prayer and I prayed along with that. Been there, done that, got the t-shirt, got that box checked. My question is, do you believe the gospel today? Will you believe the gospel tomorrow? It's only as we keep believing the gospel as applicable to ourselves day after day that changes start happening. You have to preach the gospel to yourself every day. You have to extend an altar call to yourself every day. Remember, the default setting of the human heart is thinking that we have to earn or deserve God's love. Don't think that one powerful night at a youth camp is going to reset your heart for the rest of your life. Don't think that one powerful worship service is going to reset your heart for the rest of your life. You have to wake up every morning and say to yourself, the gospel is still true today. And then tomorrow you have to wake up and say that, and the next day after that as well. Have you told yourself that there is no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus? Have you told yourself that today? And are you committed to telling yourself that tomorrow? Believe the gospel to become a Christian. Believe the gospel to grow as a Christian. That's my invitation to you this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And that means me. I don't have to earn or deserve your love. Long before I even came on the scene, you had already cleared the path for me to come to you by removing all the sin and failure that blocked a relationship with you. Thank you, Jesus, for carrying away my sin on the cross. And some need to believe that for the first time today and become Christians. And some need to believe that again today so that they can live and worship and think and relate to others as Christians. Help them to do so. Help me to do so. And we pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen.